Assalamu alaikum. Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Your Excellencies, for being here this morning. Thank you, all of you, for being here. Today, I'm going to talk to you about how we're living in exponential times. This is not going to be a typical vendor presentation. I'm going to give you some retrospective on what's going on in cybersecurity today and what we think about in the future. At DarkMatter, we say impossible is only the beginning. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about that impossible. What do we mean by exponential? Well, many of you are scientists or mathematicians or cyber people, so you know what this equation means, but it really is about moving more than one step at a time. It's doubling or moving faster than doubling. That's what we talk about when we say exponentialism. Perfect example is, for example, improvements in life expectancy. That's actually improved at an exponential rate. But another big example is just what people know as Moore's Law. In 1965, Gordon Moore looked at the rate of transistor increases and said it's going to double every year for the foreseeable future. But he wasn't the first person to actually think about that. There's been many stages of this idea, and you can see them on this slide. But there's many, many, many examples of exponentialism in technology, whether we think about storage and, you know, increases in storage availability versus price, network backbone, genome sequencing. I could go on and on with this. How does any of this idea of exponentialism affect our lives and affect what we've seen in terms of waves of technology? If you think about the waves that we've experienced recently, PCs and this sort of thing, the internet, mobility, social media, and what comes next, let's think about that in terms of exponential growth and how some of this has evolved. First of all, personal computers, I think many of us could agree that it had its exponential wave and has kind of leveled off. But I think, as we'll see later in this presentation, we haven't seen the end of the exponential growth of computing power. And I'll talk about what that means for us later. I think also some of you are probably thinking smartphones at this point, almost everybody in the world has one. But we haven't seen the end of what mobility means in terms of, for example, machine-to-machine communications and the Internet of Things. And I'll talk about that a bit more, too. In fact, if you look at every single wave in technology, one could argue that there's this exponential curve and maybe it's topping off. But just think about social media. Have we really seen the crest of that wave? Or are we just beginning to understand, for example, the political impact of social media, or the socioeconomic impact of social media in terms of solving problems like poverty or e-government? Look at what's happening in this country just with the smart initiatives in Dubai and Abu Dhabi. We could talk about Internet of Things, but it's an equation that's too difficult to solve. So rather than show you another exponential graph, I'll just start with one statistic: 31 billion devices by 2020. And that's a conservative estimate. So we are living in exponential times, except in cybersecurity solutions. And this is a problem. If we look at cybersecurity, there's endless numbers of graphs I could show you that show exponential increases. But unfortunately, those exponential increases all have to do with the bad guys. So it has to do with increases in hacking, malware, social engineering, all of the things the bad guys are doing successfully. And unfortunately, a lot of our approach in this industry has been about scarcity. It's been about coming up with point solutions, coming up with responses, coming up with, oh, here's what the bad guys are doing, let's see what we can do. That is a linear approach in response to these exponential changes that we continue to see on the part of the bad guys. And that's really unfortunate. So unnatural disasters, which are these cybersecurity events, increase at an exponential rate. Natural disasters, unfortunately, are continuing. We're seeing linear increases. Known malware, and this is, by the way, things that are known and have been published by the AV vendors versus nation-state activity, other types of exploits that are not known, exponential increases. Of course, that's the phenomena of PCs, but we know a lot of the effort of hackers has now moved to the mobile platform. And so, again, exponential increases in known Android malware, for example. I'm not even going to go into iOS because that hasn't been published, but there's a lot out there too. So what about IoT? What is happening in that world? Well, I don't have any statistics on that, but what I was able to find are predictions of exponential increases in vendor revenues for cybersecurity vendors who are bringing solutions to the table for Internet of Things security. So at some point, there'll be a graph I could show you that shows you that there will be increases in these types of problems. Unfortunately, they're also going to be linear step forward versus exponential results in terms of solving these problems in any effective way. This is the exponential slide I did want to show you on Internet of Things, which is a lot of security research has moved to the future thinking on this, on the dark side of things. For example, let's just get a collection of devices and see what we can do about just hacking them all in some way. And some of these findings, luckily for us, are published in conferences like DEF CON, but some of them, unfortunately, don't see the light of day, and we don't see these problems occur sometimes for weeks, months, or years later. So we are living in exponential times, but there are abundant cybersecurity solutions coming. And how should we be thinking about this as cybersecurity professionals? How should you, as leaders of organizations, whether you're in the private sector, the public sector, in the military, wherever you work, be thinking about this? Let's talk about what those abundant solutions look like. I'm sure many of you are probably tired about hearing blockchain and Bitcoin, and you hear about it every day, and it's like, what does this really mean? Just look at the evolution of Bitcoin itself in terms of the size of the Bitcoin blockchain, going from nowhere to, as of a couple of days ago, almost 140 gigabytes, just in that blockchain alone. Think about the impact of blockchain. One of the problems we've had in security has been that someone has to trust someone. It has to be a trusted environment. The interesting thing about blockchain is, imagine combining the value of a public key infrastructure with an environment like blockchain, where trust isn't really part of the definition, and where you can have this trustless, non-repudiable environment that pretty much forever allows us to trust all kinds of transactions, whether they're financial transactions, transactions that the military is doing, real estate transactions, wedding transactions, whatever the case may be. So blockchain, while sort of a hype thing right now, and do we or do we not do cryptocurrency, ultimately will be one of the foundational pieces of e-government, of smart cities, of everything we do in cybersecurity. And it has a lot of opportunities for us to solve problems we've never solved before. And there's another dimension to it, which is particularly interesting as well, which is the power of peer-to-peer networking. Think about just the hash rate that exists today in blockchain. You've got a one there with 16 zeros after it, 8 exahashes per second, just with the compute power of today's Bitcoin blockchain. And there are some problems with that. You know, it is a risk, for example, if somebody controls too much of this compute power. But as we as professionals think about how would we do this, for example, in this country, or how would we do that in other places, there's opportunities for us to harness this kind of compute power and do it the right way. But there's more to this story. Sure, we need to solve problems like let's not make little mistakes, and we need to make sure that we test and validate these technologies properly. But ultimately, blockchain is in our future. But what could hurt us in blockchain? Well, something like this could hurt us. Quantum computing, okay? In theory, quantum computing could be used against the current blockchain approaches to break public key encryption. If you look at inside a quantum computer, you've got this guy, Peter Shor, who created an algorithm that basically, given an integer n, would essentially find the prime numbers under that large number. So imagine a scenario where everything that we've encrypted for the last 30 years or so is suddenly visible. But again, why do we see that as a scarcity issue in security versus an abundance issue, where we embrace the ideas of quantum computing and say, given quantum computing, let's write post-quantum crypto. Let's develop cryptography that is going to solve for this problem. And let's think about how it would solve other problems. In artificial intelligence, this has been around for 30 years or so. I remember when I first heard about it, I was probably 20 years old, and that's a long time ago, and I just thought it was something out of science fiction. Why today are we starting to think about artificial intelligence as something valuable? Well, in the old days, costs of storage were a problem, limits of computing power. But as we saw earlier, there's been exponential increases in storage and compute power to where today we can say cost of storage are exponentially decreasing, and cost of computing power, computing power is exponentially increasing. So we have the ability today to take advantage of situations in AI where we can collect lots and lots of data and never delete it. And that's the food that an AI uses to basically start thinking about things and learn from problems. Learn from things that it sees and says, oh, maybe I made a mistake. Let me learn from that mistake, analyze it, and then do a better job the next time. We never had this opportunity before. Now we have it today. Now, up until now, AIs have been applied to problems like Siri, how do I find my way to the Emirates Palace Hotel? Okay, but imagine a future, an abundant future in cybersecurity, where AIs are operating on your network and they're solving your cybersecurity problems. Cybersecurity is one of the most important problems we can apply an AI to, and I think it's one that we all should be working on today. So whether it's robotics, for example, for the medical industry, manufacturing, other environments, we think about self-driving cars and other types of self-driving vehicles, whether it's planes or drones or trucks, and the sensors involved, and having all these sensors learn what's happening, or as we're doing here in this country with smart cities, we need AI technology to both operate these environments, but more importantly, to take advantage of keeping cybersecurity environments away from this. It's not going to be what can I buy and what appliance can I put in my rack to help solve this problem, but it's going to be about using this new approach to technology to solve this and thinking about it abundantly. So when we think about how we roll all this together, the message that I want to leave you with really is about resilience. Because in the past, cybersecurity has been a very reactive function. It's been about, oh gee, some guy is now hacking me, some nation state is creating problems, some criminal groups have discovered that I have all my money in a certain place over here. And then we go around and look for how to solve that problem and react to it, and hope that that reaction can somehow keep up with the innovations of the criminal world or others. I would argue that the abundant future that we need to look towards and the exponential approaches that we need to look towards are those that we're already seeing in the marketplace, where we're seeing compute power be just continuing to grow. We're seeing AIs continuing to show promise. We're seeing quantum computing. We're seeing all of these advances all around us that are being used for our convenience and being used to make our lives better. We as cybersecurity people need to get together and start thinking way ahead and thinking, how can we research this? How can we work together? How can we invest in it? And how can we solve these problems together to create resilience in these environments that will be more and more dependent on one another going forward? That's what we're doing at Dark Matter, and that's what I encourage all of you to do as you think about the way forward. Thank you very much for your time.